Good morning and welcome, friends, to our Sunday service of worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A welcome to those of you who are joining us online, and a special welcome to those of you who are here this morning as visitors or guests. We're grateful to have you with us as we worship together. A few announcements this morning as we begin. Today is the last of our table conversations on how we can reach out to younger generations and remain a multi-intergenerational church with a promising future. If you are interested in this last of these table conversations for now, I'd like to invite you to join me following the service in the Simon Peter room, which is down the hallway here to my left. We'll begin as soon as I'm done shaking a few hands after the service. I'll come down and join you. So that's this morning following the service. Today is also the last day to sign up for our annual church retreat, Connected to Jesus, Connected to Each Other, at Camp Pocomoth, down in Centerville, Maryland, along the Chester River. If you'd like to attend this conference, today would be the last opportunity to sign up. But we do have scholarships available. So if you are interested, please see me following the service. As I announced last Sunday, we have begun a capital fund campaign to raise $35,000 to rebuild our church children's playground. I have a brochure here that has some more information. Hopefully you saw it online. We'll be sending out a letter this coming week with more information about this campaign. So we're hoping to raise $35,000 before the end of October to help rebuild our children's playground. And now, finally, I'd like to invite Sandra Weidman to come forward. Sandra is a member of our missions team and has an announcement concerning our upcoming Rise Against Hunger event.
Good morning. Rise Against Hunger is an international hunger relief nonprofit organization that coordinates the packaging and distribution of food and other aid to people in developing nations. Many of you have participated over the last many years, way before I even came back here, and it's a great, great time. It's so much fun. It's Saturday, October 15th from 9 to noon. It will not interfere for those of you going to Sight and Sound later. It'll be a good warm-up. Then you can sit for the afternoon and enjoy. You can sign up online. That is available, on, I believe, on our website. It'll be in the Grapevine as well as on our Facebook page. You can also let me or maybe Doris Morris or another missions member, team member, know that you'd like to come. It's beneficial. The more people, the faster the work goes. We will be making 13,176 meals for our donated $5,000, and we need about 40 volunteers. It's fun, it's fast, and it's fulfilling. So I hope to see you there.
Again, that's on Saturday morning, October the 15th. And now let us turn to the worship of God as we listen to our morning prelude.
Earlier this morning, the choir was talking that we realize that we put our words on the screen, it's so that we can see them, but when we see our words, so do you. So rather than you watching us perform for you, we'd like to invite you into this worship experience with us. If you know any of these songs anytime throughout the service that we're up here in front of you singing, feel free to sing along. If you'd like to listen, sit in quietness, please feel free to listen and sit in quietness. Do as God leads you, participate as you feel led. Welcome to this hour of worship, where today we're going to celebrate how great is our God.
Great.
God has blessed us with life, with faith, and with community.
Let us worship God today, for God is good. Our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Let us pray together. Ever-loving God, we pray for your blessing upon us this day. Here may your faithful find salvation, and the sleeping be awakened. Here may the unbelieving find faith, and the anxious be reassured. Here may the tempted find help, and those who sorrow, comfort. Here may the weary find rest, and the strong be renewed. Here may the aged find consolation, and our young be inspired. O Lord, come this day, ever-loving God, and bless us with the reassurance of your presence. For it's through Christ our Lord that we pray. Amen. Friends, I'd like to invite you now to turn with me to page 39 in your hymnal for the covenant of baptism. Beginning there at number one. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift, offered to us without price. This morning we present for baptism Eliana Elaine Hubbs. I'd like to invite Eliana and her parents, Haley and Joseph, and Godmother Elizabeth, Liz, to come forward at this time. Sweetie. Yeah. Haley and Joseph, I ask you now these questions that have been part of the liturgy of the church down through the centuries. I ask you on behalf of the whole church these following questions. Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, answer, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression, in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, answer, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races. If so, answer, I do. I think Eliana would answer me if she could. And will you now nurture Eliana in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, answer, I will. And Liz, as Eliana's godmother, will you do in all of your power to love and encourage her in her Christian walk? If so, answer, I will. Number 8, do you as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include Eliana now before you in your care? Help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Eliana with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her service to others. We will pray for her that she may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father? Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us now join together in the thanksgiving over the water as we bless the water together. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Bear his works to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit now to bless this gift of water and Eliana, who receives it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Hi, sweetie. Hey, Peanut. Eliana, his middle name is Elaine. After your grandmother? Yep. Eliana, Elaine, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you'd like to place your hands on Eliana, on her head or shoulders, we'll say a prayer. Eliana, the Holy Spirit worked within you that being born of the water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. She's a sweetie. Yeah. She's our new sister in Christ. Yeah. Say, I could do this every Sunday. Couldn't you? Say a prayer together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of this child, this young newborn, for Eliana, the gift of life, and for her parents, Joseph and Haley, and for their extended family, for the blessing of her life in the midst of our living. Lord, we commit ourselves to her, both as family and as a church, that she might continue to grow in wisdom and in stature, and in her love for you and for her neighbor. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming up. It is now time for the children's moment in worship. I invite the children to come forward at this time. You can have a seat if you, well, actually, if you, yeah, you can have a seat. That'd be probably be best. Good morning. Hi, Bo. Blake. Hi, Gino. So we just had a baptism. Why don't you stand up for a second? Why don't you come up? I'd like you to touch the water in the bowl here. If you want to stand, you can touch the water. See if you can reach it. Hey, let me bring it down to you. Maybe a little easier. You touch the water. This is the waters of baptism. Right? It's Eliana was baptized. Do you want to touch that, Gino? You're welcome to. Would you guys like to touch the water? See how cold it is? Is it cold? Yeah. Yeah, there you go. It's going to dive in. So these are the waters of baptism. And the Bible, the Bible uses water throughout the scriptures. We read about how God uses water as a symbol or a sign. For example, let me show you a picture here. What do we have a picture of? Yep. Earth, planet Earth. And what's the blue stuff on planet Earth? Ocean, yeah, and seas. So God provides. When God created the Earth, he provided water to help care for us. Sometimes a little too much, depending on what part of the world you live in. But that's one of the ways that water is used in the Bible, is to show how God cared for us. Here's another picture. Does anybody recognize this picture, what's going on there? Yes. A volcano, almost. It looks like a little. Sophia, can you help us? What do you see there? You see people? Pushing water away. That's really good. Pushing water away. That is Moses at the Red Sea. Do you remember what happened there at the Red Sea? He parted the what? The water. So baptism is another sign of how God comes to save us. I don't know if you remember, but Pharaoh's armies were advancing and God split the water and the people walked through. So baptism is a symbol or sign of our salvation, of how God comes to save us. And then here's the last picture. Jameson or Xavier, do you know what that's a picture of? Jesus, yeah. That's Jesus down there. Jesus is being what? What's happening to Jesus? He's being baptized. Do you know that Jesus had been baptized by John the Baptist? And if you recall the story, when he was baptized, the heavens opened and the dove, the Holy Spirit, descended, and a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." So baptism is a sign that we are God's beloved daughter, that we are God's beloved son, that we are all part of the family of God. So that's what baptism represents. So you can go talk to your parents at lunch about this and let them explain to you. Let's have a prayer together. Lord, thank you for the gift of water and how it's a sign of your love for us as your beloved children and how you come to save us when we enter into times, hard times, how you come to deliver us and how you provide for us. Thank you for your children. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, Gino. Thanks for coming up.
Please join me with the prayer of the day. Good and gracious God, most near and far, listen to the silence that speaks to our need. Speak your joy into our silence and into our life, that we ourselves may bring life in the chances that we have to speak truth, to show mercy, to ease another's burden, to resist evil, to be brave, to be strong, and to be glad. Give us ears to hear you speak in the moments of our lives. Give us hearts that awaken when you draw near. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me with a moment of silence as you lift your hearts before the Lord. Praise to you, God. Amen. of the Gospel of Mark. Not to contradict you, Pastor. Today I'll be reading from Mark chapter 10, verses 13 through 16. The little children and Jesus. People were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it." And he took the children into his arms, put his hands on them, and he blessed them. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Let us pray together. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This morning, I'm concluding our sermon series on my vision. I hope it's a shared vision of being a multi-intergenerational congregation, a congregation where all the various generations from the silent and baby boomer generation to millennials and the alpha generation are present and accounted for, living together in vital Christian community, passing down our faith in God, in Christ, and the promises that we find therein from one generation to the next, multi-intergenerational church. Two Sundays ago, we considered the role and the responsibility of parents to pass on the promises of God's love and faithfulness to their children, so that through their teaching and example, their children may be guided to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life. Then last Sunday, we said that parents were meant to be alone in the development of their children's emotional and spiritual well-being. We said that it takes a village or a local church to raise a child. That in the covenant of baptism, as we celebrate it today, when a child or an adolescent or adult for that matter is baptized within the church, we as a congregation make a promise that with God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ and surround this child with a community of love and forgiveness, and that we will pray for them that they may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. That's the commitment you and I make to every person who's baptized as a community of faith. It takes a village. It takes a community of faith to raise a child. Possibly, now as ever before, we need to heed Jesus' words, "Let the children come to me." I'm personally convinced that the local church, again, can play a vital role in a child's well-being. According to the Center for Disease and Control, back in 2020, at the height, you'll recall, of the coronavirus pandemic, mental health-related emergency room visits for children between the ages of 5 and 11 had increased by 24%, and for children ages 12 through 17, 31% over the previous year of 2019. Although students have been back in school now or back to daycare for the past 2 years, in March of just this year, 2022, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services issued a report that there is a national mental health crisis in our country for children ages 3 to 17, many who continue to struggle with anxiety and depression. We live in challenging times as a people and as a nation. of all the stress that we live with. So possibly as never before is the presence of a loving, supportive community of faith essential to help children thrive. In the Old Testament or Hebrew scriptures, children were considered to be a sign of God's blessing. In Psalm 127, we read, "Children are a gift from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them." Children. Not unlike the Amish and the Mennonite, our neighbors a little to the northeast, who have an average of 7 children per family, who begin their official chores or duties around the age of 4 or 5. Back in the Old Testament, children were in part considered a blessing for utilitarian reasons, in that the way that they would help the family to make ends meet, you know, either working in the fields or shepherding the sheep or the goats. They were actually considered property, the property of their father, even after they were married, and served for practical purposes. Children were also thought of in the Old Testament as the hope of a future. You can recall in the book of Genesis how Sarah, the wife of Abraham, Rebekah, the wife of Isaac, and Rachel, the wife of Jacob, were at first barren or without child. This was not only a crisis for the future of their own family, but also it was a crisis for the continuation of the covenant community, the covenant that God had first made with Abraham to be Abraham's God, and God to be Abraham's God, and Abraham to have God as God, and his children, the generations that would share in that covenant. So children were perceived as the hope of a future, not only for the family, but for the covenant faith community. I remember reading at the time of Jesus' birth how, living under Roman occupation, many of the Jewish families in that day were naming their sons Jesus, or Joshua, or in Hebrew, Yeshua, meaning one who rescues or delivers. In biblical times, especially in hard times, there was always the hope that one's offspring might somehow be a savior, not only to the family, but to the Jewish people. Again, children are seen as the hope of a future. While there's little known known historical exceptions, as a rule in the New Testament, or in New Testament times, think Fiddler on the Roof. I know it's a little bit after Jesus, but think Fiddler on the Roof. Female children were to remain in the home where they were to receive a minimal education and training in domestic duties. That's in New Testament times. Following in his father's work or footsteps as an apprentice, depending on the family's wealth, boys were taught Hebrew, possibly in their home or in synagogue, in order that they could read the scriptures and the Talmud. Talmud is a commentary on the scriptures by which they were helped to understand what the Word of God was saying. The goal of male Jewish education was to raise a generation of men who knew, understood, and loved the Torah, who loved the law, and to secure the continuance of the covenant community. Still, by and large, children in Jesus' day, like women, were actually somewhat marginalized. Not only were children not to be heard, but in Jesus' day, they were often not to be seen. In chapter 14, verse 21 of Matthew's gospel, he records that the number of those who Jesus fed, you remember, with the 5 loaves and 2 fish, were about 500 men besides, he writes, women and children. In the gospel, in his gospel, chapter 6, verse 44, Mark doesn't even bother to mention in that story women or children. Women and children were somewhat marginalized in Jesus' society. But unlike the culture of his day, in our scripture reading this morning, Jesus appears to have a special place for children in his heart. People were bringing to him their little children in order that he might bless them. But his disciples, you recall, were sternly warning the families with children to stay away. And when Jesus saw this, the Bible says that he was indignant and said to his disciples, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And then he took them in his arms, laid his hands upon them, and blessed them. See, the disciples had mistakenly believed that children were not worthy of Jesus' time or attention. Whereas Jesus took the faith of children very seriously, using even their innocent, trusting, and loving nature as an example or a model of how you and I, as adults, might also enter into the kingdom of God if we become like them. As many of you know, my wife, Kim, is a teacher and an administrator at the Red Lion Christian Academy in Bear, Delaware. One of her joys is that our granddaughter Haley is now attending daycare there at Red Lion 3 days a week. So just this past week, while Haley was in recess, Kim was able to steal some time to go out and meet her out there on the playground. And that when Haley saw her, she ran across the playground to her mother to embrace her. Have you ever had that experience of a child or a grandchild or a great child, a great-grandchild coming to you to embrace you? This, Jesus says, is how we are to come to God. This is how we enter into the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, into God's gentle rule and realm. Through this childlike innocence and trusting. Children are so important to Jesus in Matthew's gospel that he says to his disciples, whoever welcomes one such as these in my name welcomes me. And then he adds this warning. But if anyone puts a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believes in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone was fastened around your neck and you were drowned in the depth of the sea. Wow, that's a pretty harsh warning that Jesus gives, but this was how important that children were to Jesus. We have to be careful about how we raise our children, to be careful that we don't put a stumbling block before they're coming to Jesus. In her book on nurturing the spiritual life of children, author Holly Catherine Allen writes that children have a natural spirituality and an innate desire to have a relationship with God. Young children have an innate desire to have a relationship with God, as well as with others and themselves. For those of you who grow vegetables, anybody grow vegetables from seed anymore? From seed? Yes, there's a few of you. I always cheat. I start about this high. But within that seed is the DNA of that seed, so that it's already somewhat innate that it's going to turn into a tomato plant, or a melon, or asparagus. It's already determined within the seed, and she believes, and I believe it's also true, that within every child is the DNA to be a child of God, to grow into the fullness of what it is to be a child of God. If we as parents and if, if we are blessed as a community of faith to have that child entrusted to us, we should do all we can together to provide nurture and care to cultivate them. But woe to us if we become a stumbling block to our children, if we keep our children from coming to God or coming to Jesus. Woe to us if we believe that God has no time or love for children. Woe to us if we keep from mentioning or talking about God in our homes. Woe to us. Woe to us if at least every once in a while we don't stop to take time to say a prayer of thanksgiving to God before dinner. Woe to us. Woe to us if we neglect to encourage the growth of our children's faith. How did Sunday school class go today? What did you learn? What did you hear the preacher say? Nothing? Woe to us if we don't attempt to encourage our children in their Christian faith. Woe to us if from time to time we fail to share our own faith story with our children. Not a lengthy sermon, just a few words of how God came to us in our time of need, or we were surprised by something unexpected, some kind of joy. Woe to us if we don't share our faith story with our children. Woe to us if we live life during the week before our children in a way that's incongruent with the life and the faith we profess on Sunday morning. Can I get an amen? Amen. Woe to us if children are so perceptive, if they don't see that we're living our faith throughout the week, even when we stumble, that they can see it's real and it's still vital. And woe to us if rather through love and grace and mercy, we attempt to parent or control our children through fear or shame. Woe to us if we place on our children the burden of fear or shame. It would be better for us if a millstone were fastened around our neck and we were drowned in the depth of the sea. That's how important children are in God's eyes, in Jesus' eyes. Let the children come unto me, for to such is given the kingdom of God. As parents and as a church, we have been given a great responsibility and also an awesome opportunity to help our children, a gift from God, to come to Jesus, to come to faith, a vital faith that will give them resilience in this often challenging life that they can turn to in times of trouble and rejoice in times of great joy. Who teach us also and set for us an example of how too we might have a childlike faith of innocence and of trusting and of love, that we too might enter the kingdom of God. They are our hope of a future. So be it. Amen. Have a real challenging one for you this morning, our closing hymn. We've never sung it before, and it's a little peppy, so that could be a challenge for some of us. I'd like to invite you to stand. The choir's going to help us get through. It's called Shout to the North. Anybody here before? Yeah. Okay, we'll work on that one. And now, friends, go forth in peace to love and to serve the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. May the wind be always at your back. May the road rise up to meet you. May the sun shine warm upon your face. The rains fall soft upon your fields. Until we meet again, may the Lord hold you in the hollow of his hands. Amen.